were absolutely, I think, the best band of the day. They played the best, they had the best sound, they used their 17 minutes or whatever to the best. I mean, they understood the idea exactly.
This was like a very unique event, and people say that we were so good in terms of all the creme de la creme of the music was, so that's quite an achievement.
Elton came up and said, "You stole the show," or something. I thought he's being nice, you know.
It wasn't another gig at all. In fact, I had a really bad attack of nerves in the morning because of the TV, and you knew it was being satellited everywhere.
I've seldom been so nervous, in fact, probably never. But I think it was the greatest day of our lives, even though we played only a very small part. It's the thing I'll remember above all in our career. It's an amazing, amazing day.
It sort of injected some new fuel into our bodies, you know.
We had actually planned on taking the rest of that year off completely.
A few weeks later, Freddie was on the phone. He wanted to go back in the studio and do some more recording. I was late getting to the recording sessions because I was actually on holiday at the time.
Financially, they have no need to continue to work. They have no need to continue to go through the traumas of working, which it is with the four very strong characters you have. There seems to be no desire at all to put up their feet and rest.
The band has always come first, actually, and anything else really outside Queen is sort of fitted in. I enjoy working. I don't like long periods of inactivity.
Here we are, born to be kings. We're the princes of the universe.
Our next project is this film Highlander, which is produced by Russell Mulcahy.
The film needs a big, not only a big orchestration score, but it needs a big rock score of that anthem-type quality that they're famous for. And so I had 20 minutes of the film cut together, and I brought them in, and I didn't know how they were going to react.
I think he said that he had us in mind at one point early on. We initially said no, and then we saw about 20 minutes cut of this Highlander film and thought, great, that's us.
I only wanted them to do one song in the film. They saw the footage and they said, we'll do five songs.
We found plenty of things in the plot to jump off on, you know, and to write songs. Princes of the Universe, which is about the people, not about us, it's about the people in the film. Who are immortal. We shot that video using bits of the film, but we sort of integrated the two by using Chris Lambert. And so he sort of, he's in the film, then he suddenly strolls and he's on stage with us.
The main plot is kind of violent tale of immortals fighting each other to the death. There's a kind of subplot which is a tragic love story, and it comes about because the hero cannot die, so he falls in love with this girl in the Highlands, and she gradually grows old and dies in his arms, and he has to say goodbye to her, and he has to go on. And that really came across to me very strongly, and I related it to my own life, I suppose, and everybody's life. I thought, you know, love always does come to an end at some time, you know. And so I had this song immediately in my head, which is called Who Wants to Live Forever.
Wants to live forever. Who wants to live forever? Ooh. Who dares to love forever?
I ended up writing a slow ballad, which is called One Year of Love, and that goes when he eventually decides to have another relationship with a woman again, because he vowed he never would again because it hurt him so much the first one.
Just one year of love is better.
I'd just been a bass player all my life, you know, with the band, it wouldn't be so satisfying to sit here now and sort of that would have been my input. I only consider that as part of what I do. I mean, the actual, you know, actually writing songs, having and also being involved in the decision making processes, you know, or arguments or whatever, is nice. You know, I mean, it really feels that you're part of the, you know, of our own destiny, really.
I mean, John's been writing quite a lot now, and he just writes in that one area which he likes, and I love that because I love to sing on songs like that. Brian writes from the guitar, so we have that element, and then Roger, I think, writes from the drums, or whatever. He sort of crosses over a lot, so we have all kinds of things.
So I think we're all still trying to use this beast which Queen is as a vehicle to get our own ideas across, and we all write very different kinds of songs, and it's quite a challenge to get them through this kind of machinery and get them out. If I write a song which has a particular idea behind it and I can hear it in my head, I then go take it to the other three and they will see it totally differently and want to do it in a different way. And some of their input will be very good and very necessary, and some of it will probably actually destroy the meaning of the song. So you've got to be, there's all this interaction going on all the time.
Most of our songs are developed in the studio these days, whereas before we used to have routining time. So we used to try and write our songs, but I think these days there's no time for anything. So I mean, we just book studio time and we just go in there.
Freddie certainly adopts a very different persona within the band as opposed to when they're performing. Freddie is often a very compromising force in terms of the healthy rows, and that really is what it's about. I think that so much of the success of Queen has been the openness of the rows and arguments that have happened.
If we make these harmonies, then we've got another two-part harmony coming in, and then whoa, I haven't got anything to sing. Might as well be a fucking Andrew sister.
Roger's track, which is Magic, I mean, he did it in a totally different way, but I just felt that there was another commercial streak, and I just realised that he was going away to LA for about a week, so I just got hold of it, and I just changed it around completely, and when he came back, I said, well, what do you think? And he said, oh, I like it.
John, you're here, of course, to promote the new single, A Kind of Magic. You look kind of strange on that video.
Oh, I was dressed as a tramp, really. Yeah.
The Kind of Magic video was actually quite cheap to shoot because we did it in this disused theatre, so we didn't need any props or any sort of background or anything. It was all there. But the money would be spent on doing animation. It's going to be heavily animated, so that's going to cost a fortune as well.
I think the idea of a complete soundtrack album puts quite a lot of people off, really. I think they're imagining sort of all sorts of orchestral links which don't really do anything. It's really just background music, which it isn't at all. It's a fully fledged Queen album. And all the songs from the film are songs in their own right, and not just pieces of film music.
You did, six songs for the movie?
Yes, we on the new album, yeah, there's six songs from the movie. And we've also got three new songs as well.
There is an inward jealousy all the way through our history, you know, and that's what Queen albums have been made of. And there's this push and there's this hunger and there's this sort of fight to get the best songs out.
They're a tremendous challenge. They've always been very demanding, demanded perfection, all four of them, which is a great thing to work for because there's a response then if perfection comes through.
The thing we're all looking forward to most at the moment is this European tour.
And that's quite a commitment from us in a way, really, because Freddie is sometimes a little reluctant to go on the road these days.
It's been a while since we actually did a tour. It's very, very exhausting for me to do what I have to do. The stages are getting bigger and everything, and you know, and I just like to feel that I'm perfectly fit to do these shows, you know, not just sort of say, yes, I'll do it.
We're starting on it now, really, ideas for the staging and lighting and that sort of thing.
This particular tour you're doing, I mean, you're taking a 160-foot stage, which is the biggest ever constructed for a rock act.
Yes, it's an absolutely massive stage. It's really been designed to cope with the places that we're playing in, to get the optimum out of those places.
Well, we usually go in some place like a film studio, which has this big open, like an aircraft hangar space, and just set everything up and go put everything through its paces. It's not enough for us to be rehearsed. We make sure every single lamp, every wire is set up, so everything's going to be given a run through, so all the bugs can be ironed out before we get on tour. It's like a full dress rehearsal.
We've been playing for so many years now, we do feel very relaxed playing, you know, in quite big gigs as well, really.
Strange enough, when you're used to large audiences, 100,000 is almost less terrifying in some ways than 5,000. I'm taking my bath, my curtain calls. You brought me fame and fortune and everything that goes with it. It's a strange thing with our band. The bigger the audience, the better it seems to work. The audience contact seems to be better with the larger audiences.
Once you're on tour, I like to get on and do it. I don't like to be hanging around on tour. I like to get in as much as you can, because you can build up this great rhythm and you get into the mood and the feel of playing, and you play better each night, I think. You know, if you see us at the end of a tour, we're a lot different from what we are at the beginning of the tour, always, because we're in that rhythm. I suppose it's almost like being an athlete. You just work on yourself and you have nothing else to think about except doing your bit for that 2 hours as well as you can.
Was a trend a few years ago, you know, with the punk movement or whatever. They said, "Oh, we want to play to the small audiences because we're being intimate and all that." Load of rubbish. I mean, everybody who wants to be a star wants to play to the biggest audiences.
The fans were insane to enjoy 6 hours of music, while the support groups were performing. The main attraction, Queen, arrived backstage by helicopter. There was heavy rain during several parts of the show, but fans had been warned about showers beforehand, so most people had anoraks and umbrellas. Wearing his crown, lead singer Freddie Mercury appeared out of a puff of smoke.
I want to play to as many people as I can. The bigger the better. In everything. I love that.
38,000 people snapped up tickets within days of them going on sale to see the first English concert of Queen's European tour.
Lads any have been going past saying, any tickets for sale, any tickets for sale, and we're just saying, no.
Queen have made the Newcastle concert a charity event. The Save the Children Fund should benefit by about £50,000 from tonight's concert. Magic, 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 magic.
We've been away a long time, and the tickets will go on sale for Wembley on Friday. And it's always a time where you sort of go, I wonder what is out there. I wonder if they still do want to see us. You know, you never know.
Suspect, please.
And we'll only know once the applications start coming in.
We can't just go out and play now, you know, say, oh, we'll do this number, we'll do that number. I mean, obviously, there's certain numbers, you know, that we have to play, the bigger hit. But choosing from the rest of them is quite difficult. It really is quite difficult. And, you know, there are some numbers that we've forgotten what key it's in. Because we've got such a vast amount of material over the years, we actually do forget some of our older numbers.
It's so difficult, because when we make an album, there are lots of songs that are very hard to play on stage. They don't really automatically fall into a visual element. But and so sometimes a lot of very good songs are not done on stage, because we just feel they're not right.
I think there's only one country that you've never been to before.
That would be Hungary.
Right.
Yeah, Budapest.
So that is new ground, even in this...
It's great, yeah. We're very excited about that. There are people from all over the Iron Curtain block coming. So I know they're selling tickets in... or whatever they do over there. Do they sell tickets?
I presume so.
Give them away. I don't know. Whatever they do. The people are coming from Poland and Czechoslovakia and a lot of the Eastern Bloc, which is very exciting. Of course, the Russians had never let us in.
5 perc óra kaput nyitunk, a közönséget engedjük befelé.
I like doing places that we've never done before to see how they're going to react. Because, I mean, some places that we've already been before, we have a certain idea of how what they're going to do. But this is going to be great. It's going to be great to see if they do the same things, if they have seen the films, and whether they're going to do the same things for Radio Gaga and things like that. That should be very interesting. That's a good challenge.
I want to see Queen concert, but I haven't ticket.
Getting better.
Hungary is one of the more open countries of the Eastern Bloc. And bestriding the Danube, its capital Budapest has the beginnings of a mixed economy. Nevertheless, the familiar music is of the classical variety, and the arrival of rock, with its million-dollar paychecks, a relatively new phenomenon. A party to celebrate drummer Roger Taylor's 37th birthday took place in Freddie's presidential suite, at a princely cost of £5,000. But what does Queen get out of a visit to Hungary?
There's no profit to be made. I mean, that's not the idea at all. I mean, it's impossible to make a profit. There's a tremendous feeling of sort of, I suppose, job satisfaction is a strange way to put it.
It's quite good to get job satisfaction after 14 years.
Well, it's a pretty good job, isn't it?
And interview-shy Mercury faced the Hungarian cameras.
So you look at it as a beginning of your friendship with Hungary and with Budapest, and it may last long as Queen will last.
If I'm still alive, I will come back.
You know. Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you. Fine. Thank you.
That's good. Bad. Oh, that's great. I wish all interviews were that short.
State record shops had a limited supply of the recent Queen album, pressed under license in Yugoslavia. The Hungarians are record mad. Local bands can sell 500,000 albums. But Queen are aiming to break into the whole Eastern Bloc market of 300 million potential record buyers. The other incentive is a feature film of the concert, made by a group including the State Film Corporation, which mobilized 17 cameras to shoot 25 miles of film of the concert, at a fraction of the cost of a similar venture in the West. This will be released throughout the East this autumn. As the crowd awaited Queen's arrival, there were the usual warm-up bands. So after that lesson in stage presentation from Hungary's Zizi Labor, it only remained for Queen to try and compete. And the ever self-effacing Freddie Mercury made his familiar, timid entrance. But as well as undiluted Mercury, Queen provided quieter moments and delighted the audience with some bars of Hungarian folk song. The Hungarian fans responded like Queen fans just about anywhere else, and were treated to a final glimpse of Freddie laying claim to another music business territory.
How does it affect you when you know that you've won an audience that size?
I've always been an audience.
So how are you affected then, every night you play to a crowd that big?
Actually, that's the part of my role. I have to win them over, otherwise it's not a successful gig. You know, it's not a... It's my job to make sure that I win them over and make them feel that they've had a good time. That's part of my role. That's part of my duty that I have to do. And this sort of cliche of saying that you have them eating from the palm of your hand is, I just feel that the quicker I do that, the better, because then I feel that I can manipulate them or whatever. But it's all to do with me feeling in control, and so that I know that it's all going well. Is this all going well?
Very well.
The Queen Magic Tour began 2 months ago in Stockholm. It ends here. Rock concerts have been held at Lebworth since 1972, always supported and enjoyed by the Lytton Cobold family themselves. The concert reached its climax with the arrival on stage of Queen, determined to enjoy themselves on this, the last date of their European tour.
Unimaginable what's happened. And we always believed that we had something special and that we could do anything that anyone else did. This kind of thing, you know, that's the kind of belief that kept us going in the early days. But I don't think we quite believed what would happen. I don't think we even knew what was possible.
I think that in some form or another, the music will always continue now. I think they've reached that status that their music will be remembered. How much longer they record, goodness only knows. Nobody knows whether Mick Jagger will be singing when he's 65 or Queen will be performing as Queen. I think that the Queen structure will continue on and they will continue to make music, but how it will be, nobody ever knows that, really.
We're the only sort of, the four grand dames that have actually sort of stuck it together.
Yes, you do ask how long it's going to go on, really, and we've been doing it a long time now. And I don't know. If I could tell the future, life would be quite boring, I think.
Probably the biggest rock band in the world now. Most successful.
Don't know. Dire Straits are doing quite well.